It brought us the Roaring Twenties, the Space Age and the Information Age, the 50s and the 60s. Radio, television, satellites and cell phones all caught up in a swirling sea of change. And it introduced a new voice in music, our voice. From the ground to the air to the sky to the concert hall, this has been the American Century. Welcome to the American Century, an exploration of America's modern musical legacy, hosted by David Dubal. The American Century is brought to you by American Century Investments. American Century, with over 40 years of investment management experience.
This is David Dubal. On today's edition of the American Century, we have six composers to grace our program. They are James Cone, Nathaniel Dett, Elliot Carter, Edward McDowell, Frederick Koch, and John Philip Sousa, but it will not be a march we are going to hear. I think it's an interesting mix, the kind of program which only radio can achieve. Let me begin by reading a letter by Ernst Levy. It was written in 1945. Levy, by the way, was a pianist and composer, an extraordinary pianist, who taught at MIT for a while. He wrote, "To humanity looking for elements of hope, music ought to be an important matter. We may even say that man will begin to recover the moment he takes art as seriously as physics, chemistry, or money. There is no other human activity that asks for such a harmonious cooperation of intellect and soul as artistic creation. Music is human, and music is also extra-human, inasmuch as it is a mirror of universal laws. To destructive analysis, music opposes synthesis. To the uniformization of science, which reduces qualities to quantities, music opposes a hierarchy of values. Our mechanized minds need to be musicalized. We have developed only half of man's possibilities, or rather, have developed that half completely out of proportion to the other half. We have deified the intellect. We have separated it completely from the other side of human nature. We must seek a synthesis. Music as an art and as a science can do it. This is not a petty problem. It is the central problem of our time." That was a letter by Ernst Levy. I very much like his thinking. In fact, if ever you have thought of studying music, this is the right moment to do it. Let's begin with music by James Cone. He was born in Newark in 1928. He lives in New York City, writes music in many forms, and this music, I think, is very well made. Today, for his first appearance on WQXR's series The American Century, we'll hear the Allegro Non Troppo movement, it's 5 minutes in length, of his 1981 Quintet for Winds. The performers are Marina Puccinini, Matthew Dine, Michael Finn, John Manassi, and Joel Tarplay. Thank you. That may have been your first exposure to the music of James Cone. We heard the quintet for Winds, Opus 36B, the last movement. Marina Piccinini, Matthew Dine, John Manassi, Michael Finn, and Joel Tarplay were the wind ensemble. This is the American Century, and let's continue with an album titled A Century of African American Song. Contains a dozen composers from Roland Hayes to Hall Johnson. We're going to be listening to music by R. Nathaniel Dett, and he's best known for a 2-minute piano piece titled Juba Dance, which was premiered way back in 1915 by the Australian-born pianist Percy Grainger. Dett's dates are 1882, died in 1943. For many years, he taught at the Hampton Institute, where he taught soprano Dorothy Maynor. Dett recreated the rhythmic and vocal character of the authentic tradition of the spiritual through his concert works. We are to hear I'm a Travelin' to the Grave and Ride On, King Jesus. William Brown is the tenor with Ann Sears at the piano.
traveling to the grave. I'm a traveling to the grave, my Lord. I'm a traveling to the grave. For the lady's body down, I'm a traveling to the grave. I'm a traveling to the grave, my Lord. I'm a traveling to the grave. For the lady's body down, my father died shouting, singing glory, hallelujah. The last word he said to me was about Jerusalem. I'm a traveling to the grave. I'm a traveling to the grave, my Lord. I'm a traveling to the grave. For to lay this body down, my mother died shouting, singing glory, hallelujah. The last word she said to me was about Jerusalem. I'm a traveling to the grave. I'm a traveling to the grave, my Lord. I'm a traveling to the grave. For the tomorrow in Galilee. Want to go to heaven in the morning. If you see my father, oh yes, just tell him for me, oh yes, for to meet me tomorrow in Galilee. I want to go to heaven in the morning. Oh, ride on Jesus, ride on Jesus, ride on. In the morning, if you see John the Baptist, just tell him for me, for to meet me tomorrow in Galilee. I wanna go to heaven in the morning.
That was William Brown singing two song arrangements by R. Nathaniel Dett, an American composer who died in 1943. The pianist on that album, Ann Sears. I'm David Dubal, your host for The American Century, heard each Sunday at 12.05 p.m. on WQXR 96.3 FM. We turn to music by Elliot Carter. It's a piece finished in 1948, and we'll listen only to the easiest of the movements to assimilate. The second movement, marked Vivace Leggero. Carter was born in 1908. He's probably the most honored of living American composers. His influence has been great. He's a composer who has many admirers, such as the pianist scholar Charles Rosen, but many people find him too intellectual, too difficult. Certainly, he must be listened to carefully. Well, you'll decide if you want to pursue the other three movements of the cello sonata, which you'll hear in a performance now on Phoenix Records by Bernard Greenhouse, cellist, and Anthony Makis, pianist. This is the second movement, 4 minutes 38 seconds, of Carter's cello sonata. Thank you. That was the second movement of Elliot Carter's Cello Sonata, a work of 1948. Bernard Greenhouse was the cellist, Anthony Mikus is the pianist. I think we should take a moment break before we hear the McDowell Piano Concerto. The American Century is brought to you by American Century Investments, with over 40 years of investment management experience. Let's continue exploring from the legacy of American music. Edward McDowell died much too early in our century, in 1908. He's doubtless our most famous American romantic. He composed his second piano concerto at the dawn of the 20th century. It's a grand concerto in the Liszt-ian tradition. It's the first significant American concerto, and it holds a small and honored place in the world's piano concerto literature. Today we shall listen to the second and third movements. The concerto has no slow movement. The second movement, a delightful romp, is marked presto giocoso, and the finale begins largo and moves towards a molto allegro. We're fortunate to hear the work in a performance by Claudette Sorel. She was at a rehearsal the day before the performance in February 1958, and this is what we shall hear. Claudette Sorel, distinguished pianist, pupil of the great Olga Samaroff, is heard as soloist. Franco Antori directs the New York Philharmonic in movements 2 and 3 of Edward Alexander McDowell's Piano Concerto No. 2 in D minor. Thank you. Listening to the second and third movements of Edward McDowell's Second Piano Concerto, Opus 23. The soloist, Claudette Sorrell, the New York Philharmonic, conducted by Franco Ottori. I mentioned before that Miss Sorrell was a pupil of Olga Samaroff, one of the great American pianists and teachers. And in the fall of this year, her volume of correspondence by Samaroff will be published by the University of Maryland. Let's continue with three small works by Frederick Koch, a fine composer who lives and teaches in Cleveland, Ohio. Mr. Koch's contribution to the musical life of Cleveland, Ohio can hardly be described in a few words. He's won many prizes. His book, Reflections on Composing, is fascinating. It was published by the Mellon Institute. He teaches at Cuyahoga Community College in Cleveland, also at Baldwin Wallace College. We'll hear Corin Estrin perform his piano prelude titled Erratic from Five Piano Preludes, followed by the first of his three soliloquies for flute and piano, recitative. The flutist is Eugenie McAllister. Mr. Koch is at the piano. And to conclude this tiny Koch recital, the arresting Configuration No. 1 for trumpet and organ. James Darling is the trumpet. David Blazer is at the organ.
Thank you.
music by Frederick Koch, his first appearance on The American Century. We heard the piano prelude called Erratic. Then we heard number one, Recitative, the three soliloquies for flute and piano. And Eugenie McAllister was the pianist, Frederick Koch at the piano. And finally, Configuration for trumpet and organ. James Darling trumpet, David Blazer organ. We are going to conclude with a novelty by Sousa, John Philip. The novelty being, it's not in March, but from a 1910 suite, and he called it Dwellers in the Western World. Sousa was a complex man. He wrote a very interesting autobiography, and he was full of many opinions. I believe it was Sousa in 1908 who was very fearful of the oncoming of recording in music, and he called recorded music canned music. He was convinced that the recording of music would destroy amateur music making. Well, recorded music has indeed thrived in the age of technology, while amateur music making just barely trickles along. Well, bless those that play music on whatever level by themselves at home. Let's hear this curious music by John Philip Sousa. We hear The Red Man and The Black Man, movements 1 and 3 of the three-movement suite called Dwellers in the Western World. Richard Kapp conducts the Philharmonia Virtuosi. We'll be right back. Red Man and Black Man from Sousa's suite, The Dwellers in the Western World. We heard the Philharmonia virtuosi, Richard Capp, conductor. And that concludes today's program. The American Century is brought to you by American Century Investments, with over 40 years of investment management experience. Return with us next Sunday at 12:05 p.m., where we celebrate the American composer of the American century. This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.